I'm sure they will stay. 828-1000 is the number to call.
Here. Councilor Creelman?
Here.
Councilor Dahlback?
Here.
Councilor Jordan? And Councilor Pearson?
Here.
Please rise and join me in the flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
May we have a motion on approving the minutes of the number seven meeting held October the 12th, 1992.
Second.
All those in favor? 5-0. Citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. Anybody in the group that would like to discuss anything tonight that is not on our agenda, this is the time. If not, why forever hold your peace? Reports and correspondence. I've got a few things that I'd like to do right now, if I may. Number one is a great thanks to our town clerk, Deborah Pizzo, and her crew on Election Day. A wonderful job and the highest vote I think that we've seen in Cape Elizabeth for a long time. Thank you. I'd like to also congratulate Jane Amaral, one of our citizens who are being elected to the State Senate. I'd like to thank Steve Simons, not thank, but congratulate him, for being elected to the representative from our town, our area, and Lyle Kramer, not a resident of here, but a gentleman that works here and we know very well as county commissioner. While I'm congratulating people, I'd like to congratulate our fire chief, Chief McGoldrick, being named the Maine Fire Chief of the Year. This is the first ever award that has been given. I think it's wonderful. The October the 22nd, we had a regional waste meeting on the DEP letter that said our landfills would be closed as of December 31st. We're taking all due steps at RWS to see that something is done between now and then, and we're scheduling a vote on the board for our meeting later in November, and I'll be able to inform the manager and you people at the next meeting. We're going to have council workshops this Thursday, November the 12th, and another one Monday, November the 16th. With that, are there any other reports or correspondence from anybody on the council?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, just a continuing keeping people up to date with regard to the work of the Cumberland County Budget Advisory Committee. We're continuing to slug it out, so to speak, with the various departments in the county, and we did wrap up our work, as you know. Essentially, our report needs to be in by November 15th, essentially, because the commissioners must approve a final budget no later than December 15th for their submission to the State Department of Audit. And I just wanted to let people know that we are, you know, chipping away at the overall budget that had originally been presented to the nine municipal officials making up this committee. And we are sending recommendations to the commissioners, which are several, but I think the most important one is that there was unanimous agreement that our first recommendation to the three commissioners would be that there would be no net taxation increase to municipalities over last year's. That would be exclusive of the circumstances of the new jail. So essentially that was our first recommendation. A variety of other recommendations really apply to the process more than to the content. So I'll let people know as the budget continues to be, worked on and re-presented to us. But we'll hope for the very best with regard to the bottom line as of December 15th. And certainly any other input that citizens of Cape Elizabeth would like to direct either through me or any of the other members of the budget advisory group, please stand invited to do that.
Thank you, Councilman.
Any other reports, correspondence? Hearing none, we'll move right along to the citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. I think I took that up already. Item number 69, to consider a report on the purchase of a new ladder truck and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Tonight, I'm recommending, along with the fire chief and the ladder truck committee of the fire department, the purchase of a new ladder truck for the town of Cape Elizabeth. The ladder truck that we'll be replacing is from an original 1950 ladder that was somewhat rebuilt in 1980. So we're really beginning with a truck that's 42 years old. One of the issues that has come up regarding the truck is that earlier in the year we mentioned that the cost of it would be likely to be around $325,000. As you see in the memorandum before the council this evening, the amount that I'm recommending is $345,000. The primary difference is that the $345,000 includes something called a waterway, which the fire chief will be explaining exactly what a waterway is. At the time the estimate was put together for $325,000, it was, I think it is, as I recall, about 9 months ago when I met with the ladder truck committee of the fire department. I think it's fairly safe to say that not much of anyone on that committee had a whole lot of experience speccing out new ladder trucks. The last time that we specced out a ladder truck, I was 6 years yet to be born before the last time Cape Elizabeth might have even thought of specking one out. So it was not an area that we had a whole lot of expertise in. Nonetheless, subsequent to that meeting of the ladder truck, a number of specs were put together, in fact, very detailed specs. Bids were sought, and bids were recently received. In making the decision about the waterway or no waterway, you know, I'll leave up the details up to the chief. My reason for recommending the waterway is for the reasons the chief will explain, but I'm also trying to look at this as long term as possible. This particular ladder truck that the town will be purchasing will still be in service when I'm 65 years of age. I'm not too sure, I won't guess how old some of the folks otherwise in the room may be, but we're really looking at a ladder truck. We're really looking at a ladder truck that, you know, that will be utilized by volunteer firemen, hopefully volunteer firemen, that are as yet unborn. So the decision you're making this evening is one that really has a very long-range implication. And, you know, when you look at the waterway as a safety mechanism on it, I think we need to look not only at the short term, but the long term as well. This is going to be really the major firefighting piece of equipment that this town is going to be utilizing for the next 30 years. With that, I will ask the fire chief, Phil McGuldrick, to come up and to explain exactly what a waterway is and otherwise explain the details of the bid process.
While the chief is getting up here, if Mr. McGovern will be 65 years old when that truck goes out of service, I'll be 101, so I think that clears things up.
I think the easiest way to do this is I have a couple pictures that you can look at that will be passed around. I think the explanation is that we're talking about an $18,000 difference spread out over 30 years, so we're talking about a $600 a year investment. It wasn't so many years ago that you used to see firefighters riding on the back of fire engines. That's against OSHA. That's against firefighter safety laws today. They have to ride up front, most likely in enclosed cabs now. So we've seen a big change in the safety of firefighters today. This pre-piped waterway, if you will, is something that most ladder trucks, and as I explained, wrote to you in my memorandum, most ladder trucks being built today have this pre-piped waterway on them. I think what you're going to find is within a matter of a few years, NFPA 1904, that's the standard for aerial ladders, is going to make it a requirement that these trucks have pre-piped waterways on them. Again, as the men riding the back step of yesteryear, it's putting this aerial, putting a hose line with a deck gun on the end of it, a ladder pipe on the end of it in operation, can be a hazardous situation at best. And the recommendation, I think, from NFPA, within just a matter of a few years, will be that all ladder trucks be equipped with a waterway. My professional opinion is that this is an investment that's going to pay dividends. I think I explained to you in the memo that it would take anywhere from 3 to 4 firefighters 10 to 15 minutes to put a ladder pipe in operation. That's 3 to 4 firefighters that work together on a day-to-day basis. That's 3 to 4 firefighters that do this full-time professionally. The problem that we would run into out here is there are times when we'd have a hard time getting 3 to 4 firefighters together in a hurry. And if we did and we spent a great deal of time training these people in the evolution of putting this hose and the ladder pipe on the end of the ladder, there is no guarantee that those same 3 to 4 firefighters are going to be there at the very next call 2 months down the road or whatever the case might be. So as I stated again, I think it's something that is very time-consuming to put a ladder pipe in operation. One firefighter driving the aerial ladder could go into a farm, barn, if you will, with an attached farmhouse to it, and one firefighter could put a ladder pipe in operation all by himself in about 3 minutes. Now, if you didn't have 3 to 4 firefighters there, you've also got a pumper that's got to come, that's got to supply the water for the ladder pipe. And if you don't have 5 or 6 people to do that job, and again, the best time you can be looking at doing it that job is 12 to 15 minutes, when we could take a firefighter with a ladder and a firefighter and with a pump, 2 firefighters with the technology the way it is today, and they could start flowing 1,000 gallons a minute in about 3 to 5 minutes. So it's a time factor. In this day and age, it's a manpower factor. I think you're all aware that we're dealing with volunteers. In the daytime especially, we have a hard time turning out large numbers of firefighters, and this would be a big help to those people. I know some people are concerned, and I am as well, with the budgetary situation that we're dealing with here. I want to assure you people that I'm aware of the budgetary problems that we're facing today, and I think if you looked at the bids that came in, you'd see that the price on one of the trucks that we spec was $365,000. That is a truck with a pump on it that could be delivered today. While I would like to see that piece of equipment, and I feel I could justify that piece of equipment to you, I did not make that recommendation to you because I felt it outreached what it was that could be expected. And that's why I came in with the recommendation on $345,000. I'll be honest with you, I've been criticized by some of the fire chiefs in the area for some of the things that I've done because I haven't gone with the custom pumpers, for an example. Because my feeling was that in a lot of cases, and you'll see the last 2 purchases that I made, we were able to do with commercials. So I won't always come before you and say, this is what you ought to have, which is the most expensive. I will come forth before you with a professional opinion and lay out all the facts to you and justify what it is that I'm saying to you so that you can be the ones that make the decision.
Thank you, Chief. Anybody on the council got any questions for the Chief while he's right up here?
I don't know whether this is for the Chief or whether it's for Mike, but What, if any, consideration was given upfront to a waterway?
To the best of my knowledge, in talking with the people that were on the truck committee, they were dealing with a dollar figure. And they, all of those people on that committee have told me that if they hadn't been restricted to what it was that they were doing, that they would have supported the waterway. But they were told that this was the top dollar figure that they had to deal with, and therefore they spec'd out the truck without a waterway. But to the man on that committee, they've told me if it wasn't for the financial restriction that was given to them, they would have recommended a waterway.
The recommendation which came, and again this may be more for Mike than for the chief, said that the ballots would come from either or both of undesignated surplus and from the fire equipment reserve fund. Could you explain how much is in the fire equipment reserve fund, how much would come from that fund, and what that might cut into in the way of other items that might have been budgeted for the year?
I'd be happy to. Within the fiscal year 1993 budget, in the fire department outlay account, $73,401 was budgeted, and that was budgeted specifically for the ladder truck. Aside from that, when the council deliberated during the budget process, it was agreed that the town would try to replenish its surplus, which had been somewhat low, by 20% this year, or roughly $130,000, that any amount above that $130,000 would, go into the ladder truck fund so that in order to diminish the amount that would need to be borrowed for the ladder truck. Subsequently, that amounted to $268,000. It ended up that the fiscal year turned out better than we might have hoped. Hurricane Bob came along, and we had some reimbursements for departmental activities. Some other issues happened, so that we had a better fiscal year than we might have hoped. Those two fund sources add up to $341,401. In order to fund a full $346,000, you would need another $4,599, and I would recommend that come out of the surplus, which is now at $801,000 in total. That would reduce it by approximately $4,600.
Thank you.
Any other questions while the chief, Councilor Jordan?
This is more for the manager, I believe, than for the chief, but if you want to stay there and look pretty, I'll continue on. My point is, maybe we got to go different with the budget, because we had to have an increase this year, and then we end up with a surplus of over $268,000. And I would like to know where it come from sometime or another, and why we didn't know that at budget time when we was putting it together. Because I still think we could have reduced the budget down to a zero increase and still got the ladder truck, paid part of it this year and part of it next year. And
is that a question or a comment?
That's just a comment, but if you want to comment back, it's accepted.
Yeah. You'll be meeting with the auditors at a workshop this coming week, and you did receive the financial statements in your packet on Friday. I went through with Councilor Chapel earlier today the details of where the surplus came from. It came through departmental savings. It came through $200,000 that was cut during last year's uncertainty when the governor recommended that revenue sharing be eliminated. It came from slightly better excise tax income. It came from Hurricane Bob and the other coastal storm when Cape Elizabeth was declared a disaster area, and it ended up that our departmental budgets were almost full during that period in public works and public safety were funded by the federal government. Those are the highlights.
Thank you. If I may, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to continue on with another comment. I'm in favor of this, a lot of pipe on this truck, because thinking of the future, and it would take less manpower to get it into operation. But I was disturbed a little bit at the process, and maybe the council is somewhat to blame with saying that you only had so many bucks to put the truck together. And I think it would be wise if the council here would vote in favor of purchasing it with the waterway, because it's something that's you're going to want within the future, and they'll be coming back and asking if they can purchase it at a later time. And now is the time, and it appears to me to be about the best price that you could get on it. And I just hope that the rest of the council will agree and feel that it's something, if you're looking into the future, that should be purchased at this time. But I'm still disappointed that I couldn't get a zero increase on the budget for this year.
Let's restrict it now to the chief, if we may. Any more questions for him, so we can let him go sit down. Carl.
Council Chapel. Just a couple of questions, Chief. With this waterway, what type of maintenance might be required to maintain it so that it is serviceable at all times? Especially, I think, more any type of piping that's going to be used in a straight position, especially in cold weather, must have chances to freeze up. And if that happens after the water stopped pumping, what, you know, just explain a little bit about that, if you will.
First, from experience, I've been dealing with a 1975 aerial piece of equipment with a piped waterway on it. So that's, 17, 18 years old. And we've never had any difficulty with the water pipe, the waterway leaking or anything like that, other than damage that it took inadvertently. But we've never had any problems with the waterway on that truck in that many years. And it gets used probably more frequently than this one will get used. As far as the water operations in cold weather goes, these trucks are equipped with what they call an automatic dump valve on them. If you should have the waterway up in the air and you should start to contract the waterway, obviously you can't compress water. It will open a dump valve and allow that water out. It would be the same thing if you started to freeze it. As you started to compress, you'd force the water out of the dump valve on the truck. So you shouldn't have any, there should not be any problems. These have been used throughout the country, and particularly in our immediate area, and to the my best of my knowledge, nobody's had any problems with the waterway in that regard.
Okay. Follow up too, though, to keep it serviceable. You know, obviously, it's not going to get as much use here as it may in a larger metropolitan area. What type? I mean, does it have to be used? You know, like something that if it's not used at least once in a while, how do you service it? How much time is involved to get it, you know, operate it for a while and then shut it down? And any estimates of what those costs might be?
The standard training that this department does will take care of any problems that we have, let's say, with, as you're referring to, lack of use. And I would say that again, these are Teflon rings on the waterway, and they don't take any maintenance. Again, I can refer to 17 years of use and not having to replace those seals. So, and again, if it was something that wasn't used, again, the nature of the Teflon seal, you won't have a problem with it.
Okay, thank you.
Just to help provide a little more background information, I know this happened before you arrived, could you tell us how many times the ladder truck has actually gone out and how many times the current waterway has been used?
To answer your question about the number of times that the ladder truck goes out, the only thing that I can tell you is it seemed like, obviously, I was in the adjoining community, and after the purchase of that truck, which cost $380,000 3 years ago, it spent more time fighting fire in Cape Elizabeth than it did in South Portland. So it was used, and it was used quite a number of times. I cannot sit here and specifically tell you how many times that ladder truck is going to be used. What I can tell you is that Like, we purchase 1,000-gallon-per-minute pumpers for this community. This community or any other community around us, probably 94% of their runs, they use less than 500 gallons of water. So we could say the same, we could use the same scenario. Do we really need to buy 1,000-gallon pumpers? No, we don't need to. But the problem is, if we have a small fire, that 1,000-gallon pumper works. If we have a big fire, the 1,000-gallon pumper still works. And it'll be the same way with this aerial ladder. It is not something that you'll use on a day-to-day, nor will the waterway on it be used on a day-to-day basis. But I can tell you this, that if the waterway is on there, there is a lot more chance of the waterway being used than there is if it's not on there. And I'll give you an example of going into a house fire with a minimal manning situation in the daytime and fire blowing out the second floor window of just a house and having a minimal amount of people. Tactically, we don't like to do this, but if we've only got a couple people available to us, we could stick that ladder pipe in the window of that room that was on fire and put the water to it with just two people. Now, if we didn't do that, it means that we've got to put people, four people, to get a line into the building, into position to put that fire out in the building. Again, tactically, that's the way we like to do it. We like to push the fire back out of the building. But if we get caught flat-footed with lack of manpower like we can in the daytime, we could stick that pipe in the window with just two people, and we can lick that fire just like that. So what I'm saying to you is, I think you'll see that it will be used more than they used to say, well, we didn't use it very much with the old one. No, because it took you 15 minutes to get it into operation. By the time the 15 minutes is over, you'd either lost it or you'd put it out.
But we still don't know how much it was used. Maybe one.
How price. I can't. No, I can't. Okay. I can't tell you how many times it would be used, Phyllis. I'd like to.
No, in the past, the old
In
one.
The past.
Yeah.
How many times was the ladder truck itself used?
Oh, I asked that as well as the waterway. I heard the waterway might have been used only once. Is that right? Because of its complicated assembly.
You must be looking for somebody else in the audience to answer your question.
Maybe once a year we use it.
Okay.
Your numbers show us. We had 94 fires last year and rolled 46 times.
The ladder truck did.
Okay.
And again, the point that I would make, that even though it was only used a few times, my feelings are it will be used much more often.
Mm-hmm. For now. Yes.
Councilor Creel.
Well, just before I got to the meeting here, I had the whole fire department in my backyard. Mary Dowell's car went over the cliff, and I thought it was all staged just to get the group out there and convince me that we needed a ladder truck, but I guess it really had nothing to do with that. You know, I think this issue for me is turning into one of being, I guess, penny wise and or pound foolish. You know, we're talking $18,000 today, and it sounds like we'd be silly to not purchase this extra piece of equipment. If indeed, in your memo here, Chief, we do run a risk or a substantially higher risk of the chance of a firefighter being injured, I guess, you know, certainly none of us want that to happen. The one thing I did want to ask about, however, on the second page of your memo, you do outline in a list for us about $9,000 worth of cuts that could take place, apparently, if we wanted to try to trim the cost down. I mean, is this stuff all fluff on the truck, or basically, how could we truly get that $9,000 off, or are all of these items essential to the operation of this truck?
I was trying to bring this price down. We've all been dealing with the committee, and I, since I arrived, have been dealing with how do we hit that $325,000 figure and still get us a piece of equipment that will do the job. What you see here are items that we can purchase down the road so that we could get that price down for you.
Just on that point, Councilor Creelman, all those things were cut out with the exception of the performance bond I recommended be funded on the cover sheet to the chief's memo.
Mm-hmm.
So that would be done, as well as the expenses to pick up the truck in the chief's memo it's, you know, it was the savings if we didn't have the truck delivered, but there wasn't the corresponding expense to pick up the truck, and that was added in the front cover.
So would it still be similarly in that ballpark? The $9,000 ballpark, are you saying take $2,500 off?
No, the sheet in the front already takes out all of those things.
That's already gone entirely?
That's already gone.
Right now?
With the exception of the performance bond was put back in, as well as the expenses to pick up the truck.
Okay. Thank you.
Anything else for the chief? Thank you, Chief.
If I could make one last comment.
Yes, sir.
While $345,000 may seem like a lot of money, if you would divide that out over the 30 years, you're talking about $11,500. That's probably less than the price than you're going to pay for cruiser cars, for an example. And you need to think about what this piece of equipment can do. And it's got a 100-foot aerial ladder on it. It's got a waterway on it. It carries multitudes of equipment for rescue, forcible entry, and all of your firefighting jobs. It'll carry six people. It's a real good piece of equipment, and for $11,500 a year, it's a bargain.
Well, we've got some extra people here tonight in the audience. Is there any public comments on this particular item that you'd like to make at this time? Anybody? Okay. The chair will entertain a motion on this particular item.
I would move that we acquire the fire truck as recommended.
Second.
We moved and seconded that we acquire the fire truck as recommended. Discussion on the item.
Yes, the recommendation.
I was just asking the council if you want to put a figure on the motion.
I think the figure recommended is a net amount of $345,000.
That's the figure that was seconded.
Any discussion before we vote? Councilor Congressman.
I'd like to ask Mr. McGovern if there is another source of that $4,000 other than tapping the general fund. We're paying for this outright, is that correct?
That's right. You can take it out of surplus, or you could take it out of council contingency.
Is there anything left in that?
Yes, there's more than sufficient to pay for this.
Anything else? I've got to say at this time that I was against this $345,000 for one reason only. I'm for a new fire truck. I voted for a new fire truck. But I voted for one for $325,000, and I figure it's my job as a councilor to keep it down to $325,000. The chief wasn't with us at that time. I had full faith in the committee that worked so long and so hard, and I'm perfectly willing to go along with $325,000 plus the bond, plus going out there and getting it and so forth. See no problem with that. But after hearing everything tonight and hearing the chief, and realizing that three things in this town are more important than anything else, and that's police and fire and our schools, I'm going to vote for it too. So we're ready for the vote. All those in favor of the motion? 6-0. Congratulations, Chief.
Who's going to pick it up, Chief?
Who's headed to Wisconsin?
Who's
from
going to Wisconsin?
I am.
You can add my name on that list if you want to, Chief. Item number 70. To consider a request from the town of Falmouth to participate in an advocacy effort related to state funding of schools and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern.
Yes, we recently received a letter from the town of Falmouth asking Cape Elizabeth to participate in a coalition that would look at the state school funding formula and how it affects particularly communities in southern Maine and what are generally known as the low receiver communities. Some of the folks in the northern part of the state sued the state of Maine saying that the educational funding formula is unfair. This is, in essence, a response to that suit. Falmouth is taking an interesting approach. It's one that, you know, probably needs some more thought, some more study. I privately have had quite a few discussions with the folks in Falmouth over the last 6 to 9 months, being a little bit unsure of the direction. Nonetheless, you know, this is an issue that is going to be discussed quite a bit in the legislature, and I think it is an area that Cape Elizabeth ought to take an active role in. Whether or not it's true this approach that Falmouth is doing or some other approach, I'm not sure. My recommendation on this particular issue is that perhaps you ask the school board for their advice before you actually take a vote on this. You might also check with Senator-elect Amaro, who is co-chairing the state task force, looking at the educational funding formula, and perhaps when you meet with her and the other member of the delegation, it is an issue you might want to discuss.
Any discussion? Councilor Jordan.
I got a couple of comments on the memo that was sent out, and I just couldn't understand the figures and didn't believe that that they were so far off. Just for an example, there must be some other factors that go into this. Just for an example, in 1989, the median household income in South Paul was $31,877, but in the town of China, it was $34,441. That made they had a plus of $2,564. The annual housing cost in South Paul was $9,336. In China, it was $7,680. The income tax, 20%, in Sao Paulo was $6,375, and in China was $6,888. The net household income in Sao Paulo was $16,166, and in China, it's $19,873. Subsidy in Sao Paulo was $773, and in China was $3,022. The percentage of education cost and reimbursement by the state in 92-93 was 19.71% Sao Paulo and 71.80% in China. And I have one here that I worked out with Wells and Buxton, and they come out similar the same way. Now, I thought they were poor community. What else goes into these factors here?
There's two primary factors that determine the funding that one gets from the Department of Education. The first and foremost is the property valuation within the community. In your South Portland, China example, South Portland is a very high valuation community, so it receives a very low amount from the state. China may have higher income, but it's very low valuation, so it receives a lot from the state. The other factors our school population, too, and I said there were two, but there is a third major factor, and that is the amount that a community actually spends for education, or the effort. So you have to look at those three areas, effort, valuation, and school population.
But you take the town of Wells and Buxton, which is another example here, and their figures come out similarly the same, but Wells subsidy per pupil in 1991 is $160. And Buxton was $2,726. Now, I think we better join up with Falmouth and see if something can be done, because I think it's way out of whack.
Yep. The problem with Falmouth and some of the other approaches is that, you know, they're looking at income as, you know, ought to be the major factor in determining how much one receives in educational subsidy. I'm not sure that that's a factor that's beneficial to Falmouth, and I know it's not a factor that's favorable to Cape Elizabeth. The town planner recently put together some numbers that she gleaned from the census that showed that we were at 213% of the state per capita income. Well, we were 2.13 times what the average was in the state. So it's an area that we ought to look at closely. And you know, if you do want to participate with Falmouth, you know, you would have a lot more say in exactly what they're proposing. At this point, we don't have any say since we're not a member of the coalition.
Well, we also have to consider how expensive it is, cost of living in a particular community, not just in the income. That is one of the considerations, isn't it?
It's a consideration that the task force being co-chaired by Jane Amrow is looking at. How that will come out in the process, no one on that task force is quite sure at this point. They haven't really gotten to that point yet.
Well, I think perhaps we should wait until the school board decides on this issue and have a discussion.
Can we make that them?
I move that we delay any decision on this until the school board has met and discussed the issue and made a decision.
I'll second the motion and just ask a question. Is the school board going to be taking this up tomorrow night? It is. Okay.
Moved and seconded that we table this for now and wait till the school board comes back to us with a proposition. All those in favor? Opposed? 5-1. Thank you. Item number 71 will be taken up by our chairperson who finally got here.
I'm going to get your name tag as you go up there. Your name tag is that one, Jim. That's up front.
Thank you very much, Councilor Chappell, for filling in this evening. We have another important engagement. Thank you. Now we all know who we are. Item number 71 is to consider a report from the Appointments Committee and take any necessary action. Councilor Creelman is the chairman of our Appointments Committee, and I'll turn this item over to him.
Thank you very much, Council McLaughlin. I'm delighted this evening, in behalf of the Appointments Committee of the Town Council, which is made up of myself and Councilor Chappell and Councilor Dahlbeck, to make several appointments to our town's boards and commissions. The first person that I'd like to recommend appointment is Mark Wilcox, and Mark would be filling the Planning Board Associate position. He would be serving the unexpired term of Tim Eichenberg that will be expiring in March 1, 1993. And then secondly, I would like to recommend Robertson Breed to join our Board of Sewer Appeals, and he would be serving the unexpired term of David Bridges that will expire in March 1st of 1993 also. Then, as you know, we recently, we the Town Council, established a Cape Elizabeth Middle School Building Committee, which was which was going to consist of 9 citizens. 2 members shall be members of the Town Council, and 2 members will be members of the school board. These individuals, these 4 people on the committee, would be chosen by their respective chairs. 2 members of the general public will be chosen by the school board, and 2 members of the general public would be chosen by the Town Council, utilizing the appointments committee process. And then the chair of the committee will be chosen by the Town Council chairman and the school board chair. The Appointments Committee did meet, and we were joined by Ann Chapman and Jan Soland of the school board, and in a gesture of one town parity and trying to make all things work well, the group and the entire group really decided on all 4 of the other members to this committee. So it is with great pleasure this evening that I announce publicly the 9 members of the Cape Elizabeth Middle School Building Committee. They are the chairman, Paul La Liberté, Robert Howe, Phil Philbrick, Michael A. Roy, M.D., Jeffrey White, Esquire, Ann Chapman, Richard Dalbeck, Charles Greer, and Bill Jordan. And then there are, by the constitution of this particular committee, two ex officio members. They will be Constance Goldman and Michael McGovern. So I would submit, Council Chairman, that all of these individuals I've so mentioned be appointed to the respective committees.
Second motion.
Thank you. We have a motion and a second. Do you have any discussion?
I would only like to just be catching you at your breath there. Just to underscore again, we had just a superlative group of individuals who came to be interviewed, you know, for the school building committee. And I'm very grateful to all of their interest and their real sincere efforts at wanting to serve the town in this capacity and reassure them that they're certainly will be positions opening up very soon on many town boards and committees, and you'll be seeing advertisements for those openings within the next month in the Courier, as many positions do expire in March of 93. So I certainly hope those individuals will you know, consider applying to other boards and commissions, as we are deeply indebted to their interest and very much want their help in the town.
Thank you, Councilor Creelman. I just wanted to say that I appreciate the good conversations that the chairman of the school board, Charlie Greer, and I have had about the middle school building committee. I think it's a very good example of the two elected bodies working together very closely and very productively, I would say. The committee members I have spoken with are excited to get started. I know Paul Liberty was meeting with Connie Goldman today to get started in anticipation of our vote tonight, of course. But I think that committee is going to move right along and do a very good job for the community. With that, I'd like to take the vote, please. All those in favor? Opposed? Thank you, 7-0. Congratulations to all of you. Still for your hard work. Item number 72, consider a request from Central Maine Power Company to install underground facilities on Lighthouse Point Road, Balsam Road, and Two Lights Terrace, and take any necessary action. Mr. Governor?
Yeah, this is an interesting little project. I spoke with CMP about it, and they informed me that this particular installation was the first underground utility, electric utility installation in the state of Maine for residential use when it was first put in. That surprised me a little bit, but when it was put in, they didn't use conduit. Didn't do a whole lot of blasting, and figured that the wire could, as long as it was buried, would more or less follow the contours of the land. Well, they've discovered that wasn't the best thing to do. And their particular concern at this point is that if the power, the way that particular system is set up on in this area, that if the power goes out, the quickest they could probably get it back on would be 8 hours. They feel that if they took these improvements, they could do it in about 10 minutes. Once they arrived on site. And basically what this involves is replacing some of the underground facilities and putting pads and, you know, the typical electrical boxes that you see in most other neighborhoods. The council members were given copies of the plan. I did check with CMP to make sure they had contacted all of the people in the neighborhood, and Todd Welch, who is their person responsible for this, told me he had spoken to all but one of the persons in the neighborhood. And that person, their next-door neighbor, assured him that the other person knew about the project and was fully supportive of it. So the people in the area have been contacted, and I would encourage you to approve these three location permits.
Thank you. Like a motion, please?
I'd move acceptance of the application.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? 7-0. Thank you. Item number 73, to consider a request for a toll location on Woodland Road and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern?
Yes, this pole location on Woodland Road is for the development of Rosewood, which was approved by the Planning Board a couple months ago, and this would enable homes to be connected to the system of Central Maine Power and New England Telephone.
Thank you. I'd like a motion, please.
So moved.
We have a motion, a second. Do we have any discussion? All those in favor? All those opposed? 7-0.
What some of the chuckling is about is the TV camera person in the back, which for those in the audience couldn't see, was just holding up a sign that said, "Mic, please."
The microphone was not turned on.
We couldn't figure out whose mic it was. Apparently it was Janice. Welcome.
Never a dull moment. He turned it on again.
Does that mean no one heard Irv before you got here?
I was calling in. Some of the fire department members and indicated they had heard him.
Impossible.
Okay. Item number 74, to consider authorizing non-essential municipal services to close at 12 noon on December 24, 1992, and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern.
Yeah, it's become traditional on, except when 12/24 Christmas Eve is on a Monday, that we close at noon. Usually when it's on a Monday, you allow us to close for the whole day, but I would hope that you would grant permission for this. Generally, also for the library, when we had these long weekends, we have tended to close, and usually I've done it and I've checked with the chairman. This particular time, I listed the whole schedule because I was really on the fence about one of the days, and that is Saturday, January 2nd, 1993. My sense is, looking at all the other times, it's people have their mind on a million other things, and they really don't care to go to the library. However, on January 2nd, if you're tired of football games or whatever, it is a spot you might want to drop by. I would like to mention that on all of the days other than 12/24, we save money by closing on those weekends because they are part-time and we don't pay if they're not working. So you do save money by closing those days. So.
Does that mean you change your recommendation on January 2nd?
No, I leave it up to you, whatever you want.
Thank you, sir.
On the fence.
Okay.
It doesn't matter to me. Okay. If you stay open, I may go take out a book.
I'll move acceptance of the proposed holiday schedule.
I'll second.
Any discussion?
I would like to suggest that somehow or other this get put into a policy so it doesn't need to be voted on every year.
I would have loved to have done that in the past, but you know, the council, whenever we used to ask to close on Christmas Eve at noon, it used to pass by a 4-3 vote. And I
try us.
If now's the time, Mike.
The policy generally has been that if Christmas is on a Tuesday, you allow us to be closed on that Monday. Otherwise, it's at noon. If you want that to be the policy, I won't come back in the future.
Just try one out so you don't go through this every year. This is mishmash.
Does anybody want to amend the motion to make it into a policy? And we want to do this every year.
No, I don't think you can make this into a policy. He'd have to come up with a written policy.
Councilor Jordan.
I would have to see the policy before I could vote on it because the days change year after year, and sometimes maybe you want to have a vote. But I would like to, the manager is a man of all the new words and information. I would like to see him come up with something beside non-essential. I always thought all your employees were essential. If not, maybe a budget time we could get the non-essential ones up the budget.
If I may, that's a carefully chosen word, and because what happens is, particularly on Christmas Eve, certain services may become essential by nature of the weather or otherwise. Our past experience, when we opened later on Christmas Eve here at the town hall, we were definitely non-essential because no one bothered to come in and even say hello.
You're still
so
we're
essential.
Non-essential. I had to have a comment.
Any further discussion? The motion is to approve as presented. All those in favor? Opposed? 7-0.
Can't vote against.
Merry Christmas. Happy New Year.
Happy holidays.
Happy holidays. All right. We now come to the point of our agenda where we have citizens' discussion of items that are not on the formal agenda. Is there anybody who would like to address the council? Seeing none, I take a motion for adjournment, please.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you very much. Good evening.
You know,